easy to navigate and easy on the eyes? Easy.
Mother in a church hat clap, man, that sugar gave her color purple coming back clap. When that whole week beat you up and stress you, but you hear that organ playing and remind you of your blessings. And on another note, she just hit another note. Chills down my spine, got me crying, make me overload. You don't know about it though. Old school church hymns, deacons get the humming out of drum, I'm finna burst in.
Lordy, Lordy, Lord.
Can you hear me now? Church close, sweater, you don't care, you just how we made martyrs out of these fathers and rose up all of his daughters to glorify him with honor. Man, I swear I saw Miss Jones with her head then. Now it's flying everywhere, she don't care what her head did. She an egg, yeah, caught up in the egg, yeah. Probably why she clapping like Jesus just reappeared.
Give me that God Almighty, that God old Bible, that old school doctrine. Give me that truth for the body, ain't nothing new about it, but it's still one power.
On his feet, I wanna do the type of shows that the Lord wanna see. What I mean, if I can make the whole church clap, but ain't a clap in the heavens, then that clap's just a clap, clap. For a son glorified, sin mortified, the Holy Spirit going word that truth ain't more than that. It sound doctrine, gets birthed in the coming out. Nothing wrong with singing loud, but that ain't where the power's at. On the church, church has been clapping at week sermons, leaving the week hurt, no one's changed by Sunday service. We need discernment, check what you be affirming, cause the church can be full of members but empty in conversions. Preach the gospel and stand back, look for changed lives, not for hand claps. Love people well, oh they can't stand at the church, just the church when the words won't stand at.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. To shore, safe to shore.
Back to life. if you can grab your seat, that would be great. It is great to have you with us this morning. See everybody connecting, chattering in the house of God. You are most welcome this morning. Are you standing? I didn't say stand. Grab your seat, everybody. It is great to have you here. It's just taken a little minute for everybody to get to their seats. Yes, Stephen, it's not all about you. Stephen's just waving at everybody on the platform. Listen, it is so great to be in God's house this morning. And I just want to center our thoughts a little minute as we come into the presence of God. And just remind you, I really hope that you have lots of fun in church this morning. I really hope that you make some new friends this morning. I really hope that this is a safe space for you to be this morning. But more than anything, I really, really hope and pray that you encounter and experience the presence of God in your life this morning. You know, I was reading this week, and when Jesus was hung on the cross, there's a moment where he screams out, and the Bible talks about the veil was torn. And there used to be this curtain in the temple that separated us from the presence of God. And Jesus dying on the cross means that we are no longer separate from this presence of God that we can encounter this morning. So I'm going to pray this morning. Let's all stand together as we pray. God, we welcome your presence this morning. God, we know that you are true to your word, and you say that where two or three are gathered, there you are in the midst of them. And God, the preach can change people's lives. The word of God can change people's lives. A conversation can help somebody on the journey to change in their life. But God, we know that your presence in someone's life is what changes everything. So this morning, we give this next couple of hours to you, and we say, God, do what you will in our lives. Holy Spirit, for those of us who've come in broken and hurt and confused about life, let your presence change us. God, for those of us who've come in and think that it's been an okay week and we've got it all together, God, will you mess up our lives and change us to break our hearts for the things that you're concerned about in our town and in our community and in our families. God, we welcome your presence here this morning, and we choose to focus on you, to not be distracted by anything else, but to focus on you and encounter your presence this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
You are good and your mercy endure forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endure forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. To generation, we will.
are good. You are good and your mercy endureth forever. So good, Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. And people from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you.
What he's done, what he's done.
majesty, the Father's will complete. He reigns in victory. And sing hallelujah to our King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring. We lift your voice and sing hallelujah to the King. He is worthy to receive all the worship we can bring. What is God? Future is heaven. I praise God for what He's done. I praise God for what He's done. I'll praise God for what He's done. It is right to praise you, to bring the sacrifice you deserve, for those who give much and not with good will touch, cannot withhold your praise. And for there is no
Jesus.
rise again. Glory to the Lamb. Let it rise, praise ascend. Glory to the Lamb. Let it rise, praise again. Glory to the Lamb. Let it rise, praise ascend. Glory to the Lamb. Let it rise, praise again. Glory to the Lamb. Let it rise, praise ascend. Above all other names, you are holy and holy and holy is the Lord.
Worship you, God. We thank you for your presence. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. What a great time of worship together. We're so grateful for the team, aren't we, that come and serve us, all the ones that you see, and there's tons that you don't see as well. Why don't you just, we've got time for kids, Life Kids. Are you guys going to go out this morning? You've got loads of fun things planned for you this morning. Have fun. And while they're going out, why don't you just say hello to three people that you've not seen this morning yet? Give them a hug, say hello. Can take your seats. We, as you know, if you come here regularly, we are very much about reaching our world as well and winning our world. And it's amazing. We've been able to have so much influence in so many different parts of the world this year alone. And we had a team of beautiful ladies go out to Serbia just a couple of weeks ago over the half-term holidays. So I am going to invite them up to the stage, but as I do, we're just going to watch a quick video from Nesha and Vesna, who are the couple that we partner with out there, and they are amazing. So watch the screen, and ladies, you get ready if you're coming up to the platform.
Hello, Life Church. Greetings from Serbia. We are using this opportunity to say big, huge thank you, first of all, to leadership of the church, of the Life Church, for organizing again a mission trip, ladies' mission trip to Serbia just last week. It ended. It was so wonderful, and we just want to say thank you with our whole hearts. All the women that I have talked to were so blessed with your visit, with your serving, and I think that your church can be really proud of you. This was a wonderful team. Thank you, Gemma, for organizing this trip and for the planning that you have put into it. On our side, we were amazingly blessed. The topic that we covered at the retreat, freedom, brought so much freedom into women's lives. And we are so grateful for this partnership that lasts now for many years. And we are looking forward to new mission trips from Life Church to our church in Serbia, Nexus Evangelical Church.
I also want to thank you, Life Church leadership, for sending the team of ladies to bless us here in Nexus in Novi Sad, Serbia. I know you are in the middle of your big fundraising event or process, if I can say like that, and you just showed your generosity again and again, and we are so privileged to partner with you, and we love you, and looking forward to Dennis and Chris Priest's visit at the end of February, and we'll possibly come to England at the end of March, so we might see some of you, if not all of you. But we are looking forward to that. And thank you. We love you. And greetings from Serbia.
Isn't that wonderful? Come on, guys, you come up. I love what he said there. He said about how he knows we're in the middle of doing big projects here in Bedworth, but that's never going to stop us reaching out to other people. So come on, lovely ladies. What an amazing team. And I'm going to give the microphone to the gorgeous Gemma. This is Gemma, who Vesna said organized the whole trip, made it happen. And she has a lot going on in her world. Somebody said to her recently, you've got a lot going on. And she thought, you don't know half of what I'm going on. But yeah, and she does. So she, well done, Gemma. We're so proud of you.
So yes, we had an incredible week. These ladies were all amazing, every single one of them. They have all got incredible stories of how God used them and moved through them and how he spoke to them as well. So I do encourage you at the end of the service, come and grab them and they'll tell you, because there is so much. I was blown away by how God moved in the little and the big, the absolutely massive ways that he moved. So yeah, I encourage you to come and talk to them. But two of them are going to share now, and the first one, as she's here right now, is the formidable Jackie Flavel. And before Jackie speaks, I just want to say, I've got permission to say it, Jackie is 72 and this was her first overseas mission. So Jackie did so much to inspire people over there. Simply by driving the minibus, people were inspired by the fact that she did that. But I'm just sharing that to say there is no excuse. God will always have you on an adventure if you let him. So yeah, Jackie.
Thank you. Dobro jutro. You see, we're on it already. We called ourselves the Awesome Eight. We're only the Awesome Seven at the minute, because we're sending love to Anna, who is not very well. So, and the only reason we called ourselves the Awesome Eight is that awesome happens to be number eight in Serbian, so it fit in lovely. So, just a minute. First of all, let me say, for me, this was just a ticked box. I've always, all my life, wanted to go on a mission, and I got the opportunity, but it was also because of not having any holidays this year, I was able to do this. So it was also a holiday. But you know, God has different things. In, you know, you think you're just going on a holiday and ticking a box, and when he shows up, you know something different is going to happen. So, where are we now? Okay, so we had the theme of being a freedom. So we've loved, we've laughed, we've cried, and we've had an evening of slimy face masks, which I must admit was a whole level of experience for me. So, and that was all with us. But we did exactly the same for the ladies there, but without the slimy face mask, you understand? Okay. So, and we got an opportunity to share with these women, love on these women, worship with these women. And I must admit, as Yvette and Karen would agree with this, there is something absolutely beautiful with worshiping in bilingual. And sometimes, because we hadn't got our choruses up there in English, sometimes when I didn't know what the line was in English, I was finding myself going along with the Serbian bit. So, yes, there is something. And sometimes I just had to stop and listen to them in their worship. So we prayed with them, and we prayed in groups with them. And we prayed for a lady who was a bit of a monkey, to say the least, to the point that although she was in her 50s now, had been disowned by her family. For various things, and we found out there was a heck of a lot more than that. But in this group, we prayed. She never got a chance to be reconciled with her dad. But she'd always had dreams of seeing him walking in church. She'd become a Christian since then, but because there was no reconciliation, there was no healing, there was no... So we prayed for her, didn't we? And in this group we prayed. Afterwards, I took her hands and I kissed her hands. And she said, I have to... She became emotional and she said, I have to share this with you. She said, when I was a little girl and I was sorry and I went to my dad, he kissed my hands. So God is in the detail, and God shows up big time. Over to you, daughter.
it's true, we did cry a lot. I think by the end of the trip, I feel like I just looked at Liz and I would just tear up. Not because Liz is bad, but it was very emotional. I wanted to start by saying that if you don't know any of these women up here with me, you need to get to know them. Over the week in Serbia, they brought laughter, fun, deep conversations. They taught me things. They gave wonderful cuddles. We danced together, cried together, and God placed every single one of them on this trip for a reason. They all brought their own gift, and it was such a privilege to serve alongside them. Every worship session, every word that was brought, every prayer and picture shared was just incredible. I really loved running the retreat. Seeing how hungry the Serbian women were to learn and spend time in God's presence was a real blessing to me. The worship was just incredible. You wouldn't have believed that there were only 30 women in the room. It felt like 10 times that. They were loud and passionate, and it felt like as soon as we all came together, God was just there. It was like he just couldn't wait to be with us and bring his presence. Something that I learned about myself this trip was that, so because I wasn't in the worship team and I didn't preach, it would have been really easy for me to feel like I wasn't one of the like important people or one of the people that would make a big impact. And I was due to share my testimony on the first night of the retreat, which was like halfway through the week. And I hadn't actually gotten around to writing down what I wanted to say before we left for Serbia, which is bad preparation. But in those few days in Serbia before the retreat, God really showed me the things he wanted me to include. Through the people that we met and the things that he put on my heart. And this meant that I was able to share parts of my testimony that I very rarely, if ever, share. And I certainly wouldn't have planned to share. But I believe God used my vulnerability to encourage the women that we met that this was a safe space and that my sharing and the role I played did actually have a huge impact. I'm very much not a center stage person. I like to do like the background work. But God really spoke to me in this trip and reassured me that actually that work is just as important. I know that we went out there to serve the women and they were incredibly grateful and blessed by what we brought. But I can't help feeling that actually I was blessed so much more by them and what God did through them and the whole team. I don't actually feel like I have the words to describe just how powerful the week was. When we came back, I felt like I needed a week off from the world just to process everything that happened. It was just surreal and incredible. And even now, a couple of weeks later, I feel like I'm not there yet. But yeah, it was just amazing. I just love these women, and there are no words.
If you would be interested in joining next year, at the end of the retreats, Vesna said to all of us, she thanked us and she said, we really need this. And they do. Christianity in their country, we think it's low here, it's really low there. And you really got a sense that those women didn't have that connection regularly. So we'd like to do it again. So if you'd be interested in being part of the team next year, please come and find me.
Brilliant. Let's give these ladies a round of applause as they make their way back to their seats. Well done. We are so proud of all of them. And, you know, God is true to his word. As we refresh others, we ourselves will be refreshed. And I love what Caroline said. She got just as much, if not more, out of it than she did, than she gave into it. So please do see Gemma and keep your eyes and ears open for different mission opportunities that will be coming up over 2024. Can you believe that? 2024. It's crazy, isn't it? But listen, we're going to go back into a time of worship now. And, you know, let's just really press in and ask God to speak to us again. You know, sometimes when the children are in, it's wonderful. I love the kids being in worshiping with us. But sometimes it can be a little bit of a distraction. And just as we go into this next worship song, we're going to collect our offering, another extension of our worship. Let's just choose to focus on God and say, all that I am is yours, everything that I am. And the words that we're going to sing, it talks about God working all things together for good. So no matter what's on your heart, no matter what's on your mind, I don't know your circumstances. I know the God of the universe that does know your circumstances. Let's trust him that he's doing a work on our behalf. as we worship him, he's working all things together for our good. So come on, church, let's stand and we will worship together.
Jesus, you're my confidence. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that we can trust in you. You really do work all things together for good, for those who love you. Thank you, Jesus. You are faithful. We can stand on that rock that is Jesus. He is faithful. He is faithful to complete a work in us. You are faithful, Lord Jesus. Thank you that we stand on the rock this morning. You do not fail us. You will finish your job, your work in us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. 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 Thank you. Take your seats. Thank you. Worship team, so much for leading us so well. Thank you. Well, good morning. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning, isn't it? Always good to be in God's house. And a special welcome to our dear friend Paige, who's in the house this morning. Great to see her this morning. That lifted my heart when I saw her. So, this morning, a few thoughts, really, from God's Word. The title that you'll see come up says A Tale of Two Sisters, but actually I'm going to focus on two brothers from the Bible, the prodigal son. I was going to tell a modern-day story, but actually I'm going to refer to the two sons, the one who chose to go his own way. The picture of the prodigal son, the father obviously is the picture of the father in heaven, and the son who stayed faithful, and how their paths took two completely different routes. Joshua 24, verse 15 says, "But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Ammonites in whose land you were living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Think of those two brothers. One chose to go his own way. The other followed a path with his father. And what completely different places they ended up. I think of myself as a young man when I made the decision to follow Christ at the age of 19. If I had chosen, at the time, I can relate to that verse. It seemed undesirable to me. I was living a life that I loved and enjoyed, a bit reckless, but what a different path it's taken me down. And it got me thinking, the decisions we make will determine our path, which way we end up, where we land. And these decisions are critical in life, absolutely critical, which way we go. And sometimes there's the big decisions of life, isn't there, that we sometimes wrestle over and sometimes struggle with. What job should I take? Because that's going to determine where I live, and where I live is going to determine the people I come into contact with. Maybe the person I'll meet and marry one day. Critical decisions, really. Yeah. Who to marry or not to marry. Yeah. What house to buy. It's very important. I had an Indian friend who was at university. He was a very, very faithful man of God, and he used to say to me, "Don't make a mistake. Every other mistake, you can just ask forgiveness, you know. But marriage, it's for life. It's for life. So don't get it wrong." Critical decisions. And of course, the biggest decision of our lives, whether to follow Christ or to not. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, but it will determine where you end up. Big decisions, but I wanted to focus in this morning a little bit about, actually, life, whilst there are big decisions, most of the time in life, it's about small decisions. Yeah. It's the little things every day, the day-to-day faithfulness in our walk with God, the kind word, the act of kindness, the attitude to my wife or family. It's being faithful in the little things that builds life, that helps us to make the big decisions in life. Faithful in the small things. Proverbs 3, verse 5 to 6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, but in all of your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths." In all of your ways, acknowledge him. Not just the big decisions. Shall I take this job? Shall I marry this girl? Shall I become a full-time missionary? Shall I do this? That verse says, acknowledge him in all of your ways. In other words, be faithful in the small things. The things that we can control today. Naomi already touched on it. Not worrying about things tomorrow. We have things today that we can do, that are in our control, that we can be faithful in. And as we do the small things, and we're faithful in the small things, so we build resilience, if you like. We build strength in the ability to make the big decisions of life. And there's a spiritual principle in being faithful in the small things, because as we're faithful in the small things, the Bible says he will trust us with bigger things and more things. Matthew chapter 25, verse 21 says, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge with many." Now, that passage comes at the end of the parable of the talents. We're all very familiar with the parable of the talents, where three people come to the wealthy landowner and he gives them different things. He gives five talents of gold to the one who seemed to have more ability, and he gave three to the another one, and a single talent to the third. And we all know the story. The one who had five used it wisely, made five more, came back, and the wealthy landowner said, "Well done, good and faithful servant." That's this verse. "You've been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many." The one who gave three could have said, "That's not fair. He's got five. I've only got three." The issue was not how many he had. It was what he did with what he had. Yeah. And he came back with three. He'd done well with three. He made three more. And again, he says, "Well done, good and faithful servant." What about the one who had one? It's got nothing to do with the fact that he had one that the wealthy owner was cross with him. It was the fact that he did nothing with the one. If he had invested that one or done something with the one and come back with just one more, he too would have received that proclamation, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And I think often in life, we look at what we've got, or maybe what we haven't got. My lot in life is not as good as so-and-so. Things have not landed well for me. My father went off and things are not, you know. Or we can look at the things that we haven't got, and yet it's got nothing to do with what we've got or what we haven't got. It's about what we do with what we have in our hands. And that's confirmed through the widow and the mite. Mark 12, 1-4. "He saw the rich putting their gifts into the temple treasury. He also saw a poor widow put in two very small coins. Truly, I tell you," he said, "this poor widow has put more in than all the others. All the others gave out of their wealth, but she gave out of her poverty." You see, it had absolutely nothing to do with how little she had. It had everything to do with what she did with the little she had. Everything to do. She was faithful in that small thing that she had, and that was worth more than the ones who had so much more. Sometimes it's the big decisions in life that paralyze us into inaction and we don't know what to do. But life is about step-by-step faithfulness, which I said. And as I was thinking about the word this week, there's that very well-known chorus from the 1990s, "We want to see Jesus lifted high." Who remembers that chorus? Yeah. I know Nathaniel remembers that chorus because we've got a classic piece of video of him in our garden in the paddling pool in his trunks at the age of about 3 or 4, singing at the top of his, "We want to see Jesus lifted high." Have you got that? No. No, we won't put that up on the screen. Nathaniel, you're okay. But there's a line in that really resonates with me along my thoughts this morning. Step by step, we're moving forward. Little by little, we're taking ground. Every prayer, a powerful weapon. Strongholds come tumbling down and down and down. Step by step, we're moving forward. Little by little, we're taking ground. Life is not about big leaps and big jumps. I don't know if you've noticed in the Bible, it's all about taking a step. You know, I stand at the door and knock and open the door. What, to jump in? No, to welcome a step in. Yes. Psalm 25 says, the Lord makes firm the steps, not the leaps, not the bounds, not the jumps. The Lord makes firm the steps of the one who delights in him. Faithful in the small steps. Faithful in the things that we can do, that we have control over today. We can't do stuff tomorrow. We can only do stuff today, step by step. Psalm 37, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. Faithful in the little things, the things that we can do. Yes. 2 Chronicles 16, verse 9 says, for the eyes of the Lord range throughout the entire earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. There's something powerful, really powerful, about those whose hearts are fully committed to the Lord. It's like the Lord is seeking, ranging, searching, looking for those people he can find committed to him. And he will strengthen those. You see, the strength of the Lord is not automatic. It does not come to everyone. He seeks those whose hearts are committed to him so that he is able to strengthen those. Priceless in the eyes of God. He's looking for people committed to him. And I wanted us to think a little bit this morning about our promised land. What do I mean by our promised land? We've talked this morning about big decisions in life, and maybe we think often about our calling, don't we? What am I called to? I struggled with that as a young Christian. Am I called to be a full-time missionary? Am I called to go to India? And sometimes, as I said, those big sort of life-calling decisions can sometimes actually paralyze us because they seem too big, too difficult. And yet, as I've touched on this morning, it's actually about those day-to-day steps of obedience, the things we can do, and then the bigger things become clearer. But each of us have callings, have things God's called us to, and I mentioned India, and we've explored that fully and came to Wyoming, and were we going to be full-time, and did we miss our calling? And yet, I've realized as I've matured, as I've got older, that God puts things in our hearts. And he's recently, as you know, restored to us that sense of calling to India. And our part and our heart for the land of India was always there, was always part of our calling, or was always part of our promised land. But maybe it grew dim for us over some years, and God has rekindled that. Part of our promised land, part of our calling. And I thought it was good to look at the nation of Israel, not because of all that's going on in the tragic things right now. I don't have understanding or comment on those things. But from the biblical perspective of the promised land, we all know the story of Moses, don't we? How the people of Israel had lived in slavery for so long, and God used Moses to lead them out of slavery across the Red Sea and then on towards the promised land. For the nation of Israel, their promised land, the land of Canaan, a land that was reported as being flowing with milk and honey, a beautiful land, a fertile land, trees, a great, great place to live that God had promised to give to the people of Israel. And as Moses led them out, and they were in the wilderness, as you know, for 40 years, it's quite a sobering thought, because that land was promised to the people of Israel, okay? That land was promised to them. And Moses sent spies to go out into the land to check it out, see if it's good, see if the promised land really is what we would love it to be and what God has promised it to be. In Numbers chapter 13, verse 1 to 2 says, the Lord said to Moses, send some men to explore the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the Israelites. From each ancestral tribe, send one of its leaders. Interesting, isn't it? He didn't just send a group of random spies, a small handful of people. He sent the quality leaders of the nation of Israel, leaders of each of the tribes, to go into the land. And Moses sent them to explore, and he said to them, go and see what the land is like, whether the people are strong or weak. What kind of land is it? Is it good or is it bad? What kind of towns do they live in? How is the soil? Is it fertile or poor? Are there trees in it? Bring back some of the fruit of the land so that we can see if it's good. So the spies went to the land, 12 in all. And they all came back and they said, yes, the land is wonderful. The soil is fertile. The trees are strong. The land that God has promised us is good. It really is a land flowing with milk and honey. God's promise to the people of Israel was good. And yet, we know, don't we, that of the 12 spies, only two said we should go into the land. Why was that? They reported back, and the land does indeed flow with milk and honey, but the people who live in it are powerful, and the cities are fortified and very large. So 10 of the spies said, yes, the land is great, but there's problems, there's difficulties, there's challenges. I don't like the look of this. I don't like the look of the giants in the land. There's problems. And this is critical in our walk in life, in our Christian life. Amen. Critical that we understand what the Bible is teaching us in this passage. God promises us many things. Is it possible that the things that he's put in our hearts, our promised land, the dreams, the visions, the things that he's called us to do, is it possible to miss that, to not enter our promised land, not to enter into the fullness of our own promised land? Yes, it is. And we can see that from the nation of Israel. 10 said we can't do it. And as a result of that, they never entered the promised land. But it's worse than that. The number of people who came out of Egypt, I wonder if any of you know how many, any ideas? How many people were in that nation of Israel who actually walked out? About 2 million. The Bible records that the fighting men, the people 20 years of age or more who were eligible to fight in the army, so the adults really, there were 600, how many? 600 and, I've got the number here, 603,550 men. 603,550 men were in the company of Israel with their wives, with their children, over 2 million people. And yet, the Bible reports that because they have not followed me wholeheartedly, remember the verse we said before, for the eyes of the Lord range throughout the whole earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. How much God values that, our commitment to him. Here it says, because they have not followed me wholeheartedly, not one of those who were 20 years old or more when they came up out of Egypt will see the land I promised, except Caleb and Joshua. The two spies who said, we can do it, we should go into the land, God has promised it, and we can do it, were the only two adults above the age of 20 who actually entered the promised land. That's a pretty poor statistic, isn't it? 603,548 died in the wilderness and never entered the promised land. Even Moses and Aaron didn't enter the promised land. When you think about that, it's extraordinary, isn't it? Absolutely extraordinary. And yet, critical that we understand in our lives what that means. That when God says something to us and gives us a promise, and we move and we take steps of obedience towards that, there will be giants in the land. There will be challenges along the way. Let's think of our church right now, where we are. And if you like, a part of our promised land, we believe, is the expansion. But there are some giants in the land, just behind this door, this wall, people who do not want us to extend because we're too noisy. There are some financial challenges, we know. There are people in the planning committee who have delayed and delayed and delayed. There are some giants in the land, and it would be very easy for us to say, well, maybe it's not to be, and we start to lose courage. But that's not faith, is it? Faith sees what God has promised. Amen. He's given us a dream, a vision, yeah, of the promised land. Yes. Are we the 10 who say, well, I don't know, we've only raised this much and we need this much, I don't know if it's ever going to happen? You know, it won't take much for somebody in the planning committee to say no. And the giants are in that. Or are we going to be the 2 who see God's promise and stand on God's word and step by step, step by step, step by step, we move forward, little by little, taking ground. Every prayer, 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 keep praying. Every prayer, a powerful weapon. Strongholds come tumbling down. Are we going to be the people of faith who say yes to God? I believe you, God. I believe your word. I believe what you've promised us. I'm going to take those steps of faith. I'm going to do today what I know I can do. I'm not going to worry about what seems to be an insurmountable barrier tomorrow. But today I can take a step of obedience. Today I can do what I know I can do. And I will say yes to the Lord. So I can be numbered in that 2 out of 10, or actually 2 out of 653,498 people who will enter their promised land. And for us as individuals, what's our promised land? I've already touched on sort of thoughts and ideas along that. Maybe you're facing a big decision, a life decision, a job, a relocation, and things like that. And God has put in your heart dreams, visions, plans, things that he wants you to do, part of your promised land. And often the way I think of it relates to calling, and we can sometimes paint a picture of our calling being, it's this. Like for me, is it India, is it not? Is it full-time mission, is it not? Is it? And that can, as I say, sometimes paralyze us into not moving and not making those right decisions. I like to think of our calling or our promised land more as a tapestry, because life moves along different paths at different times. Danny and Naomi, when they considered coming here and sensing that calling, you've got part of their promised land, step by step moving forward. Seems like a big decision, and it was, but it was step by step by step. Yeah. And as we take those steps of obedience towards our calling, what we sense God is leading us to do, he will open the doors, he will close the doors. We don't have to worry about those things. The important thing is we move. We don't sit paralyzed in fear. That's too big a decision. I couldn't make that decision to move, to go. To move to another country even. But in a sense, God's not asking you to take those big decisions, he just wants you to take that obedient step today. Yeah. To say yes today. Amen. To say yes, I think you're asking me to do this. I'll test the water. I'll ask that person. I'll go to that place. I'll put in that job application. I'll talk to someone. I'll pray about it. Not being inactive and paralyzed, but step by step, moving forward, little by little, taking ground. You know, and it's so vital in life that we learn that principle of walking by faith. Yes. Not by the giants in the land, because resistance will come, challenge will come, life is full of challenge and obstacles and things that will come in our way. And particularly if we're seeking after God and what he's calling us to, there will be obstacles along the way. Yeah. That's just life. Yeah. That's just life. But as we learn step by step to do what we can do today and say yes to God today, those steps of obedience, step by step, moving forward, little by little, taking ground. We do move, and as we look back, it's not so much I've arrived, it's we don't arrive, you know, the people of Israel, there was a definite moving into the promised land and arriving, but it was still step by step. They had to move into the land. They had to have some battles. There was a lot to do, a lot to do. So that actual first step into the promised land was just a step. It was just one step on the journey. And I think in life, we should take the pressure off ourselves in a way. We can, as I say, get hung up on the big decisions. Take the pressure off and say, Lord, what do you want me to do today? Yeah. What thing should I do today that moves me one step closer to not the final destination? The final destination will not come until the day we die, but it's a tapestry of life that will take us through twists and turns and different directions at different times as part of that promised land. For Andrew and I, it took us to Leeds for 4 years and then brought us back here. It took us back to India just last month for the first time in 20 years. You know, the twists and turns of life as he reminds us of things that he's put in our hearts, maybe from even decades ago, that are still part of our promised land, still part of our calling, still part of what God wants to outwork in our lives. And I wonder if there's things in your heart, in your life, that you know God spoke to you about a long time ago, and maybe it's grown dim, or you think, I've lost my calling, I've missed that opportunity. God never, never stops you from entering that promised land if you will recognize and take steps again. The only reason the people of Israel didn't was because they were stuck in their stubbornness and their refusal to believe. They were not with their hearts fully committed to the Lord. He saw in Joshua and Caleb, two whose hearts were fully committed to him, and it was them that went into the promised land and led the whole of the rest of the company of Israel. There's probably by then a lot more than 2 million, because obviously they grew and they continued to grow as a nation. And so maybe the worship band can make their way back up. You know, things will happen in life that will cause us to question and ask, Lord, where are you leading us at this time? Where do you want us to go? What do you want us to do? And God just wants us to listen to that still small voice and to be obedient, to take that next step. What's God prompting? What's he revealing? What's he showing? And don't worry about making a mistake, because we just take that next step and we ask for counsel. We ask for prayer. We ask for signs, confirmations, different things. God is faithful. God is faithful to those whose hearts are fully committed to him. Be encouraged this morning that our God is faithful to his people. And if we will follow through, he is faithful. The expansion, he is faithful. Let's keep fixed. Let's keep faith. Let's keep believing. Let's keep focused on what God would have us to do. Little things in life as well. I mean, if we sense God is saying something, part of our promised land, if you like, I'll give you a little personal story, because it can be very practical as well. I believe that God has, for me personally, called me to look after myself, and I love running. And those of you who know, I love running, but Back at Easter, I visited my brother in the Orkney Islands. He's 2 years older than me. He also runs. And I was really disappointed and shocked that as we went out running together, he was talking, and I was so out of breath. I couldn't run and talk at the same time. And we were going up this hill, and I said, Jono, I said, can we just stop, take a break? And I knew that I was less fit than my older brother. And in reality, I, little by little, I love my Indians, don't you, Naomi? And I'd been a little bit less careful, and so I'd put on a couple of stone that I really didn't want. And for me, some people, I just put it straight on the front here. So I'd wear shirts that would a little bit cover that up. But as I was running with my brother, I thought, this isn't good. God's not called me to get bigger and bigger and bigger and just continue to enjoy food and go out running feeling I'm just unfit. So I set a goal in March, because I believed that, yeah, God would have me to be strong and fit and healthy for my family, for the future, for everything that God would have me to do, so that I can be all that I would believe God to be. So that was in March. That was in May. 6 months later, I've lost 2 stone and 2 pounds. You know, a little goal, but step by step, because the first month, the pounds dropped off. It was great. And then the second month, it was just static. I was still doing exactly the same thing, but it was step by step. Come on, step by step. Just keep going, step by step. Just keep going. You know what you need to do. Keep going. And then it went a bit more, and then all of a sudden, and my brother visited 2 weekends ago, and Jamie came running with me, and my brother came running, and I was chatting all the way around the route. And my brother said, last time, you could not speak. And I was chatting. And then as we came down St. Nicholas Park Drive, the youngster, Jamie Hines, put on a spurt. So I thought, okay. So I kept up with the youngster, and my brother was behind. And I got to our house first. That's just a little example. It's a practical example. But it's a principle of consistency, step by step, doing what I can do today, what I know seems a small step, but it's taking us on the right journey to the right destination, to that little bit of my promised land, which is health. Little bit of my promised land. Such an important principle. Step by step, being faithful in what we know we need to do. Another final little story, because this is really quite a challenge for me now. When things come in my railway business, it's come to a real downturn, and it's quite a challenge, real challenge. As you know, Rishi cut HS2. I worked for HS2 part of my time, but in half a couple of weeks ago. Boris had previously cut the eastern leg, completely dead. So we've got like a third of the railway we should have had. And there's a real sort of downturn in the industry. So it's challenge, struggle. What do you do? Where do we go? So you pray, you seek, you ask Lord, and there would seem to be a sort of a new opportunity, a change of direction. And Jim came to me last Sunday. Again, when you're praying, Lord, is this right? Should I do this? Should I do that? God is faithful, and he will give you pointers, and you put out a fleece, and you say, show me this. And Jim came up to me. I've not even told Andrea this, but he came up to me last Sunday and said, I had a dream about you. Okay. And he said, I dreamt that you and Andrea were in the car driving, but it was foggy. You could not see where you were going, but you kept driving. And he said, and you were driving on the motorway and towards London, so you'd set a direction, you set a course. And Jim said, are you thinking about something different, a change of direction, something? And I didn't say to Jim at the time, because I've thought about it and waited, and I said, yes, absolutely. And it is foggy, and it is uncertain, as I'm sure it was for the people of Israel. It was very foggy and uncertain when they looked at the promised land. Because what did they see? They saw the challenges. They saw the giants in the land. They saw the problems. Absolutely. When there's a promised land, a new opportunity, there's challenges along. It's not all easy and plain sailing. It's going to take some grit and determination and courage, and faithfully, step by step, I'm going to take that step and move forward. And I took that to mean, yes, I'm challenged over which direction to go, and it is foggy, and I am in the driving seat. And although Andrew can't see which way to go, and is a bit uncertain too, I'm driving, and we're heading in that direction. And the other funny thing, which I'm not quite sure what it means yet, but Jim said, and I was in the boot. And he said, I'm not quite sure what that means yet. And I'm not quite sure that what that means yet, Jim. I've got an idea, but we'll see. We'll see. So Jim is in our car, in the boot. I think I'm going to do away with him. No, I think he's there for good reason. We'll let you know as time moves on. You know, God is faithful. When we're challenged, when the things come, and yet you sense when challenge comes, it's a new opportunity. We can either sit and say, I'm done, and we get depressed and we get paralyzed and we don't move forward. Rather, when challenge comes, be it financial challenge, be it a challenge in our marriage or a challenge in church or whatever it is, we can either shut down and close in, or we can say, God, what are you saying? What do you want me to do in this situation? When I'm challenged, where do I go now? I'm not sure about this turn, but I'm going to test it. I'm going to ask, please confirm if that's the right thing to do. Please show me through prayer, through someone else, through all kinds of ways. God is faithful. For the eyes of the Lord range throughout the whole earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to Him. He is utterly faithful to lead us into our promised land if it's not automatic. It's not automatic. God made us to be productive, creative beings, not just to exist, but to be proactive. You know, the Bible talks about living life to the full, not just existing, but living life to the full. What does that mean? To our full potential. God's put so much in every one of our hearts to do great things in the world. Think about this. I said at the start about you don't think you've been given much. And it's true. It's true. There are people with much and there are people with little, but it doesn't matter. God's put things in your heart that you and only you can bring to the world. You are utterly unique. And your contribution to society, to this church, to life is utterly unique. You are the only one who can bring your flavor to this world. The only one. And God made you unique. He says, I knit you together in your mother's womb. He saw you when He created you. He saw the qualities and the gifts in you that only you can bring. So you have no right to say, I don't have enough. You have no right to say to God, I've been given little, I can't do much. What about the widow's mite who had little, but she gave what she had, and that was worth more than anything else? Talents. Doesn't matter how many you've got or how many you think you've got. Offer what you have. And God is faithful. And God will use you. And He will do something wonderful. Be encouraged this morning, church. Every one of you has a unique offering to bring in this church, in your career, in your life, in your family. You are utterly unique. And God loves that. But be faithful to Him, and He will lead you into your promised land, step by step, moving forward, little by little, taking ground. Every prayer, a powerful weapon. Strongholds come tumbling down. I'm not going to ask you, I almost feel like saying, come on, let's sing that. No. Yeah, you probably don't even know it, do you? So let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you, Lord, for reminding us this morning that you've called every single one of us to our promised land, to different things in life, to things that you're leading us to day by day, step by step, big things, small things. You've called us and you've given us a hope and a future. Your word tells us about giving us a hope and a future. And you've given us in our hands so much potential. And thank you for reminding us this morning that You don't do it for us. You ask us to bring to the table the things you have put in our hearts, the things that you have planted in our hearts, that we would bring to you and offer back to you as living sacrifices, so that we would fulfill the purpose that you have put us on this earth for, that only you can fulfill, because you are unique. And God, I pray that you would speak to us this morning in our hearts as individuals and as a church, to remind us of the things that you put in us, and that we would turn back to you in faithfulness to you, because we want to be faithful to our God. And we want to give to you the best that we are, the best that we have, Lord, as an offering, as a living sacrifice. We give it to you, God, as individuals, as families, and as a church. We say, God, lead us step by step, little by little. Today, we can take a step into our destiny, into our future, into our promised land. Yes, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just respond in your heart. If you know God has challenged you, even right back at the start where I said, if it seems undesirable to serve the Lord, it will make every difference if you choose yes or no. Come down at the end. We've got a prayer team to the left. If you want to make that commitment, that decision, that big life decision to say, yes, I want to take the path of following Christ, following Jesus, come and speak to somebody at the end to my left. Or if you just want prayer over another, a decision, something that maybe has lain dormant that you know God is bringing back to life, or a decision in life, or an uncertain, come. These people are here to pray with you, to help you on your journey, because God is faithful. We are a family in this together. We're in it together. So, Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you that you will lead us step by step. We thank you that we can trust in you, and you will do it. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you're able, would you stand with us as we worship? Speak to me now. You have all my attention. I will linger and listen. I can't miss a thing. Lord, I know my heart wants more of you. My heart wants something new, so I surrender. For a touch of heaven. We're desperate for you, Jesus. We're desperate for a word. And you're the fire in the morning, and you're the cool in the evening, the breath in my soul. You're the life in my bones. There is no hesitation in your love and affection. It's the sweetest of all. For Lord, I know my heart wants more of you. My heart wants something new, so I surrender. Desire is to know you. Jesus, have your way in me.
I open up my heart to you. The words of that song are actually so fitting for what Adrian just preached. Jesus, have your way in me now. And you know what, church? There's two people came and just whispered a few things in my ear that felt God was saying to this room. One of them is that you think you're not good enough. You think that God would never use you, that a promise is not for you, that promised land, that fullness of life, that John 10:10 life of life in all its fullness is not for you and could never be for you. And the truth is, it is. It is for you. And the other thing is just that reminder that it is a choice. We've always had this thing called free will. God never wanted to force us into relationship with him. He wanted us to choose his ways. And Adrian opened with that scripture and talked about today, choose who you will serve. Choose life, choose death. And there is a choice to be made in your heart. There's no way going through life just ambling along. You've got to choose, no, I choose you, God. I choose what you're saying to me in this moment. I choose your principles. I choose your word over my ways. I choose that you know better. I sacrifice my will and say, less of me, more of you. He must become less, or I must become less, and he must become more. And you know what, as I sang that song, I just thought, you know, at every little step, every interval of my life, I've stood as a teenager and said, God, I'll go anywhere and do anything. God, have your way. God, if I could just be in your house all the days of my life. And all those things merged together in obedient steps that have not been easy. Adrian will attest, it's not always easy, but his ways are always best. So I'm just going to ask the band to lead us one more time in that, all I want is to live within your love. and just to sing that, I don't know if it's bridge or refrain, I'm not clever enough, I don't know which bits of the song or what, but just to open up my life to you again. And this is a decision that nobody else can make for you, that says, I open up my life to you, Lord Jesus, have your way in my life. Let's just sing that through again, church, and then we'll close and we can go for our dinner. But let's trust God with our lives.
In your love to be undone by who you are, my desire is to know you deeper. And Lord, I will open up again, throw my fears into the wind. I am desperate for a touch, and all that I want is to live within your love, be undone by who you are. My desire is to know you deeper. Lord, I will open up again, throw my feet into the wind. I am desperate for
this morning is faith over fear. Lord, we say that we trust you with our lives. God, I pray that our hearts are touched this morning by you. God, I pray that you've reignited, reminded us of things that we buried so deep, calls and purposes and plans that you have had on our lives from the day of our conception, from before we were born. You had good thoughts toward us, and I thank you, God, for that, God. And I just pray for every person here, God. I pray that every person has been individually challenged and changed by being in this house this morning. We thank you for your word that teaches us and guides us. But God, we want to walk in the fullness of the life that you have for us. Lord, will you give us courage? God, will you help us to eradicate our fear and fill ourselves with faith every morning when we get out of bed to say, God, your ways are better than my ways. We choose your ways. We choose life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's show our appreciation to Adrian. What a great word. You know what? And as he said, there'll be some people down here to pray with you if you'd like prayer for that. Just somebody to stand with you. If God has spoken to you, share it with a friend. Get some accountability in your life. Say, God's reminded me of this thing he said to me when I was 18, and now I need to act on it, and I'm 65. You still need to do it. The kids are desperate to get in. Who's got Step by Step in their head, that song now? We had a dance in my youth group. It was Step by Step. taking ground. Every prayer is a powerful weapon. And then you totally did this. Strongholds come tumbling down. So, yeah, I was not on the dance team. Sorry. I didn't like to make that much of a fool of myself when I was 13. But listen, we're so glad you've been here. If you are new in the house, you are very welcome. We would love to connect with you. Do not leave without saying hi to somebody. Hopefully you've already been grabbed by somebody, but we've got a little gift we'd love to give to you. If you have been coming for the past few months, we are having a coffee and cake for new people after the service next Sunday, so you can stick around. You don't get free cake if you've been here for a long while. But we'd love to meet you. We know it's not always easy for you to connect with different ministry leaders and staff team. It would be great to meet you, so please do come along to that after church. And finally, if you would like your baby to be dedicated in this house, if you're saying, I want my son or daughter to grow up in the house of God and I'm dedicating this child to God, we would love to stand with you and take our commitment seriously in that as well, that we will champion your child. And we have a dedication service on the 3rd of December. So please, please, please do come and speak to us at Connections Point out there if you would like your child dedicated. And also just keep in touch with loads of things that are going on. We need you on social media, on Church Suite. Keep your eyes open. There's loads of stuff all through the week. And we would love to see you at all of it. But I think we'll wrap up there today because we've gone on. Got on a little bit, but be blessed. Have a wonderful Sunday, and we will see you at something in the week. Have a great week.
I come to you with a grateful heart for the things you